Welcome to Insight, produced in partnership with ValleyPBS. And today we are chatting with ValleyPBS's very own Elizabeth Laval, who is the Senior Vice President of Content and Development for the station. Elizabeth has generously agreed to share some of her experience with us. And thank you, Elizabeth, for joining us today.
Oh, Mark, we can't tell you how much we appreciate you being here.
Well, I really appreciate being able to talk about ValleyPBS and the programs that you offer, because in addition to being a conduit for PBS work that comes from the national organization, you produce a lot of your own content. So let's talk a little bit about your footprint first, because you serve an enormous geographic area that is sparsely populated with different towns and cities and isolated people who all have needs. Talk about your footprint.
Exactly. This is one of the things that people don't know about ValleyPBS. We actually serve all the way from Bakersfield in the south to Merced in the north, and that is a huge footprint. And unlike many other areas in the country, ValleyPBS and the rest of the California stations don't overlap very much. So that means we're the sole provider of public television for about 3 million people, many of whom, as you say, are very in rural areas, and they use ValleyPBS as really their only source of educational programming, especially for their children.
How do you balance your program offerings? Because yesterday I saw simultaneously on the various feeds, you had programs for elderly people, programs for very young children, and all the way in between. Talk about how you make sure that you are providing these various needs of different people, and how do you stay connected so that you know what those needs are?
This is always our biggest challenge. We do have what we call the ValleyPBS family of channels, which encompasses four channels. Our main channel, which has children's programming during the day, and then about the 5 o'clock hour moves into news, public affairs, and then adult entertainment in the evening, in the sense of Antiques Roadshow, Nature, Nova, and a lot of those are family shows as well, but they also serve our other end of our viewers who are maybe a little bit more elderly. We also started running recently the PBS 24/7 Children's Channel, so that means that people after dinner can still have their children enjoy in a safe environment, educational environment, all of the wonderful shows that PBS produces or sources for PBS. On our third channel is ValleyPBS Create. This is our how-to. We show people travel, and we show people how they can do things in their own home, cooking, so many things. So it kind of takes a number of the commercial cable channels and puts them into one form where you get to watch it basically over the air at no cost. For our fourth channel, we've added in the last couple of years is ValleyPBS World. Clearly, with everything that's happening in the world around us, it's more important than ever that our viewers are able to see international news, the NHK news, the German news. They get to see it in real time. If they tune in at that time, that's really what's happening in broadcast. We broadcast documentaries that have been on PBS, so many other types of programs. And through that, we're covering the gamut of the audience in our valley who really need to know something at whatever age they might be.
Let's talk a little bit about the tech. How do the programs get into the homes of people in this very dispersed population?
So we have two markets. We actually serve all the way from Merced in the north down to a place called Delano, and that's off of our main signal. And so you either get a chance to watch the shows over the air with an antenna, or you can have cable or satellite, and all of the channels for the most part are on there. Now, unfortunately, Comcast does carry all four of our channels, but the DirecTV and satellite don't. They only carry the main channel. It has to do with our must carry and the FCC and a lot of minutia that causes us some grief. We'd love those all to be on there. At a place called Delano, we relay our signal down to the Kern market. So for Kern and Bakersfield, that ValleyPBS is also the main channel. Most of the viewers down there are off of a cable feed that they get from us over the air. So we do manage to cover almost everything. I think we make it into 94% of the homes in our footprint, which is pretty good considering how rural some of our areas are.
And what's really important is that if you take a look, it's sort of like a rural electrification, right? If we did not have a communal commitment to ensuring that type of access to electricity or to media, to information, to education, it wouldn't happen, because there is no money that can be extracted from from sparsely populated regions in a commercial sense. So this whole idea of public media and serving the public and trying to understand what the needs are and yes. having these different routes into the home, whether it's a broadcast using just an antenna or through cable or through satellite, this is really important if you're going to serve a region like this.
Well, imagine in our region with 52% of the population Hispanic descent, and some of those folks are certainly residents and some are non-residents. It doesn't matter to us. We're serving everyone. And a lot of the farming communities, particularly in the last few years due to the drought, have over 50% unemployment.
Right.
We are in a region where only 8% of our children 5 and under have access to organized preschool.
8%.
8%. So if you can imagine, now the national average is about 50. So we're well underserved in those areas. These are the targets that Valley PBS really tries to attack.
And we're leaving our yes. riches on the ground.
That's
right. I mean,
right.
really, I mean, when we don't educate children, when we only have an 8% penetration.
It's a domino effect completely, because by the time they get to school, they're completely unprepared to the rigors of what, and still in America, and especially here in California in some districts, everybody's supposed to go to college. You're supposed to be on the college track. Well, if in kindergarten, you barely know how to spell your name,
right.
and other kids in other areas are already doing arithmetic, multiplication tables, or they know how to read, you just can't compete.
And we know what the future of the region will be
That's
if,
right.
if its people cannot compete.
There are a lot of studies that show uneducated kids who aren't on grade level by third grade have an incredible course in the rest of their life. They're more likely to be involved in drugs, they're more likely to be incarcerated, they're never going to get back on track. So Valley PBS and our children's footprint through lots of programs, we really target up to third grade where we really need to get them on track to be able to at least function at the grade level. And that's one of the things that we share with our donors. And it's one of the reasons that we have so many donors. We have over 11,000 members in this Valley footprint. We're looking to get to 15,000. If we could get to 15,000, which isn't a big number, Mark, when you consider there are 3 million people here, if we could get to that number, we could provide the services on a regular basis
so
that we need so much.
So you need to go from 11 to 15?
We do. It's just something that it's showing investment. And as we're talking about, if we don't invest in our younger viewers, then later on this community is going to suffer because they won't be able to catch up.
Well, let's get there, and then also let's inflect to the other bookend. So we've mm-hmm. talked about younger viewers. Let's talk about older viewers
sure.
as well, because I saw some really marvelous programming that obviously is geared toward older viewers. There was an exercise program that I saw.
Oh, Sit and Be Fit is what you were watching, yes.
Sit and Be Fit, and then of course there are the programs like Antique Roadshow and
yes.
sort of take people on this sort of interesting and relatable intellectual journey. Everybody has some old stuff lying around that, you know, we'd love to find out
what the value is,
or at least the story behind
sure.
it. So talk about how you serve those members of the community as well.
I think that's been our easiest area to serve, because PBS, through its programming, provides not only Antiques Roadshow, Nature and Nova, kind of the documentaries mm-hmm. through Frontline and some of those things, as well as the ever-present Masterpiece Theater on Sundays. What most viewers don't know is that we at the station have to backfill two whole nights and some other shows by acquiring programs from other sources. And that means that there's a lot of expense associated with that. So while it's true that public television is free to all, the programs that people are viewing are not free to the station.
Free to produce, free to purchase, or free to develop.
We actually have to, well, all of those things, we have to actually source those shows and pay for them and pay for the rights to some of their very, very favorite shows. So if people enjoy our Thursday night lineup with our British Mysteries and Dr. Blake and a whole lot of those shows, these are shows that are extraordinary to the PBS schedule. And we have to go out and purchase them separately. So what we're trying to get in this next year is people to understand they need to do their part. Their part can be as little as $5 a month. It could be a major donation. It could be part of an endowment. Whatever it is, if you enjoy the quality programs that you see on Valley PBS, not only for yourself, but if you believe in education for children, then you need to put some of your donations this way.
So hence the watchword, free is not free.
Free is not free. And then also what we've been really doing, Mark, is in that interim, there's a lot of times PBS is criticized for not having interest of people once they've grown out of the children's programming type thing all the way back to when they're older. But we do our local programming really with the intent of capturing not only the millennial age, but also the college student age. We do a lot of community conversations, and the topics could be anything from Latino identity in the Central Valley, where we focused on Fresno City College, we focused on the DACA program, we focused on ways that folks are trying to integrate into the Valley. We did a series of civil liberties conversations talking about, well, in relation to the Japanese incarceration during World War II, what happened in America after 9/11? What happened to the Muslim population? And by proxy, the Sikh population and also the Hindu population. We also had a conversation that we taped up in Merced as a way to try and make sure we cover our footprint with young people talking about racism in America today. What does that word mean? What did it mean to those in World War II who faced the ultimate racism of being incarcerated even though they were American citizens? So in our local programming, we really try to take on issues that are very specific to the Valley. And that's one of the most important things I think that we do.
Well, you make a very good point. The history of the Valley, its people, its contribution to America, its contribution to California. If we do not create our own visibility, nobody else is going to do it for us.
Exactly.
And if we talk about not being counted, not being heard, we also have to look at ourselves. If we're not investing in our own voice, if we're not voting with our resources to ensure that others pay attention,
yes,
to what we are and who we are and how we have been and the lessons we have to teach the country, then we are depriving others, but we're also depriving ourselves.
And this is one of the things I love the most about being a part of the PBS system. Local stations can really select the trajectory of their own local programming.
They have their own voice.
We have our own voice.
You have your own anchors. You have your own sensibility.
And as we're looking,
There's no corporate person telling you what you must say or what you must do.
That is an absolute no-no. We'd never let anyone that funds something have any influence of the content, and our viewers know that. But as we enter another major election cycle in the next couple of years, we're going to see people here disenfranchised once again. Maybe they don't know how to register to vote. Maybe they are afraid of the census that we've been hearing about is coming in 2020. All of these things are programs that we can create to help educate. We're not taking a point of view because that's not the PBS way. Our job is to provide information and let our viewers make informed decisions, but really getting rid of that culture of fear. I don't understand how to read the propositions. How am I going to vote on them? I don't understand what's going to happen to me if I register to vote.
Well, you are taking a point of view. You're just not taking a partisan point of
view. We're not taking a partisan
point of view. Your point of view is, which is very clear, you want people to be talking to each other.
Exactly.
You want people to raise concerns. You want there to be a vigorous dialogue. All points deserve some consideration.
And it has to be heard, and where better than public television to make that happen? We can have seminars, and they're wonderful, and they all start dialogue, but it's so much of a smaller scale. But with Valley PBS and our multimedia approach to everything, every program we do is not only on air, it's online, it's promoted through social media. Our community partners take that content. They can spread that content to their groups. And people that might not want to come to the studio and be filmed, but really need the information that we're providing, we're kind of delivering it to them in the way that they like to watch it. If you prefer to watch one of our shows over the air, our local shows, you can do that. If you'd like to watch it online in the privacy of your home, you can do that. And almost at every turn, we have a website filled with resources and information that goes beyond the broadcast.
So this is about civic participation.
Absolutely.
It's about civic cohesion. You do make calls. There's no way with four channels and 24 hours that you can air everything.
We can't.
But so you make calls, but I guess what you're saying is that your sensibility is you're trying to do your best to serve the different constituencies that you have, the minority constituencies
yes.
of people living between the large cities, the majority constituencies of race, ethnicity, or living in a big city.
Gender, age, all of those different things,
without reference to some sort of partisanship.
Exactly.
Just the idea that we're America, we ought to be able to communicate with each other and share knowledge.
And I think this is the beauty where public television, because we are not being dictated to by corporations or funders, or we don't have to run 15 minutes of commercials in 1 hour. We have, in our whole day, less commercials or less breaks than a typical cable channel has in 1 hour. So when you watch something on Valley PBS or any of the PBS stations, it sticks. You're concentrated, you're in the show, you're not interrupted. And that's something that is where all these other models going online and binging and watching these things without interruption is the model PBS had adopted decades ago. So I think it's interesting. There was a time when people started to say public television's going to become irrelevant because you can get everything you see on public television elsewhere. But the tide has turned. The channels like A&E and all these channels that started out talking about we're going to have arts and entertainment programming. If you ever watch those channels, that is not what's on there. Here at Valley PBS, we still air over 500 hours of arts and entertainment programming every single year. It's something that we're very proud of and something that introduces someone way out in the country who just happens to turn us on. Maybe they'll never see a ballet in person, but they'll watch that on Valley PBS. They might hear opera, they might hear folk, they might hear artists that inspire them to learn an instrument or to move along, and that's really what our mission is all about.
In terms of the future, where do you see this organization evolving to? You have scarce resources,
yep.
Every public media station does. You need 4,000 more members, but with those scarce resources, you need to develop and you need to remain vital. You need to remain connected to this internet-connected world
yes.
where the broadcast signal and you as the intermediary to content is no longer your value proposition.
That's right.
How do you see this organization evolving?
I think that one of the things we do the best is create partnerships. And it's going to take a plethora of partnerships across not just our own region, but across the PBS region. We're starting to work with other stations, and if we all put in a little bit of resource, we're getting content that matters. For example, we've applied for a grant. We do a lot of grant programs, and that's really how we fund a lot of our work, where we want to do this Young Latinos in America program. But it wouldn't just be here in the Central Valley. We'd be working with stations across the country and making content that's valuable to all of them. And it might be online. It might be something that young people online are going to be able to watch. I think we need to have creative thinking out of the box, but we can't at this time yet forget our roots, which are donors who provide the vast majority of the funding. You know, we only get 20% of our funding from the federal government. People have the misunderstanding that PBS stations are funded by the federal government. 100% of that 20% goes right back out to buy the PBS schedule. That means that every single dollar we have to tape what we're doing today, to have lights on, to have the air conditioner on sometimes, except when we don't want it on anymore because it's making too much noise, but hire one staff, 100% of that money is raised right here in the Valley by Valley residents or grants, and it stays here in the Valley. And that's something we really want the viewers to understand.
In terms of the independent productions that you do, how do you shape them? You have an interesting team here that, from my experience in meeting with everyone, people don't view their jobs as being in a little box.
Oh, no.
So talk about how you incorporate the different ideas, the input of a very diverse staff with different backgrounds, with different career trajectories, different sensibilities, in how you invest your resources in the future of Valley PBS.
I'm so proud of our team because sometimes we just have to take the chance when opportunity knocks. A grant might come, and it might be something that we've never ever tackled before. But our team is so versatile, and I think that they would all agree, we can ask them afterwards, I think they would all agree that one of the reasons they like working at ValleyPBS is their job is different every single day. They come here with open minds. They understand the need for research. We have a good team. We'll reach out to community partners to ensure we're going in the right way. And we have never had a time where we couldn't find community partners to help us make sure we're creating content that makes sense, that's accurate, that portrays a point of view. But I think it's because we're adaptable. And most PBS stations would say the same thing. You don't come to work, have one job, and it's going to be the same 5 days a week.
Right.
And at 5 o'clock on Friday, you check out. Right now, we're in the middle of an incredible series of workshops that's funded by Chevron called Engineer It Girl. It's for children, kindergarten to third grade. We're holding these 5 workshops out in the most remote areas of Fresno County this time. We've done them in Kern County. And our crew will be out there filming Saturday morning. It doesn't matter. Whatever we need to do, wherever we need to be, our crew is adaptable, and I'm really proud of them.
That is so cool. You know, it's a group not of order takers. It's a group that pulls together, and it's a group that lends their creativity, their energy to a work product that does ValleyPBS proud. Elizabeth Laval, thank you so much for sharing some of the work of ValleyPBS, and we need 4,000 new members. And thank you so much.
Thank you, Mark, so much. We can't tell you how much we appreciate you having us on.
Thank you. Thank you
so much
for your insights.
It's my pleasure.